I am Mr. Taru. That was a quiet jump. In this video, we're going to continue our discussion of limits, the basic idea of limits and how they you find them for calculus. So, I just did a video of finding limits both graphically and numerically, basically just looking at graphs of functions and identifying their limits, both the left and the right-hand limit, and if those are equal, there's a two-sided limit. And so finding them with t-tables, but both of those techniques are very tedious. So now we're going to start looking at properties of limits and learning how we can just use algebra to and not have to make t-tables and graphs to find limits. Now this video is going to be mainly just I'm going to run through the basic properties. I'm going to have along the way some very, very basic examples that apply to each one of those individual properties. And then in the next video, we're going to do lots of examples that you know, might be a bit more challenging. This video is just the identities. If you just want to see examples, you want to wait till or watch my next video. Okay, properties of limits. Well, let's not forget, if we're just learning limits, that we're finding a limit of a function, we're letting x approach some a value on an open interval, and from this function, the limit of this function, as x approaches a, is equal to L. And L is a basically y value, the response variable, the dependent variable. What is the y value of the function approaching as x is approaching the value of a? So, keeping that in mind, we're going to talk about the two most core basic properties that's going to allow us to do everything else that's in this video. All the other properties are going to use these two. So I'm going to take time with these two and make sure I attempt to explain them as best I can for you, and then hopefully it helps you for the rest of the video. So, the limit of a constant function. A constant function is, the constant function is f of x equals c. And in calculus now, you should be used to the function notation, but just temporarily, I'm going to let that f of x look like a y, and really force the idea that you see that that's y equals a constant value. And even way back in Algebra 1 years ago, you started learning that y equals a constant number is a horizontal line. So this blue line is a specific example. It's, y equals 2 is an example of a constant function, or f of x equals 2. Okay, and, again, what is a limit? We'll be given some value of a to allow x to approach, and we're going to be approaching that value of a from both the left, denoted by a negative exponent on a, and from the right, denoted by a little plus sign in the exponent of a, and we want to approach that value from both sides and hopefully get the same answer and have that two-sided limit we're looking for. Well, a limit is a y value, so when your line is a horizontal line, if you have a constant function, it really doesn't even matter what a is. No matter what x is going to approach, you're going to be getting the same y value. That is the deal with a horizontal line, or y equals a constant. No matter what x is, the y value, the function value, is going to be equal to whatever that constant is. In this case, with the drawing, 2. So, to the little identity or the property here, the limit as x approaches a of c, being a constant, the limit of c as x approaches a is equal to c. Basically, if you take the limit of a constant, the answer is that constant itself. The y value that graph, that constant value have, that constant function has, that horizontal line, is going to be the same everywhere, and thus, you don't even see a being factored in here. The limit of c as x approaches a is c. It's constant, it's a flat line. The limit of the identity function. Now the identity function is f of x equals x, or again, just temporarily in some simple algebra terms, y equals x. So y equals x is a line with a slope of 1 and a y-intercept of 0. So I've got it drawn here. Now the deal is, no matter what x is, the y is the same. I mean, it says y equals x, f of x equals x. So the answer is the x value. If you allow a to be here at 2, then as you approach a from the left and a from the right, the y values are going to approach, the y value of 2. So the limit of x, that's the actual, right side of the equation, that's the actual, the function, the limit of x as x approaches a as x approaches a, but there's nothing here but an x. So if x approaches a, this is approaching a, and thus the limit of x as x approaches a is a. And again, it does make sense if you go back and you just look at this constant function y equals x, f of x equals x. Whatever x is approaching, in this case 2, the y value is approaching the same thing, which is also 2. So the limit of a constant is the constant itself. The limit of identity function, the limit of x is x approaches a, is going to be that value of a. These two basic properties are going to do or help us work through all these other basic properties that we'll run through in the next probably 10 minutes.
Bam!
Okay, we got three properties up here. We have the limit of a sum, which says the limit as x approaches a of f of x plus g of x is equal to the limit basically of each of those terms. So we take the limit as x approaches a of f of x, we take the limit of g of x as x approaches a, and then add them, which is what it says right here. The difference, if you can add two things, you can subtract them, right? So the limit as x approaches a of f of x minus g of x is equal to the limit as x approaches a of f of x minus the limit as x approaches a of g of x, and you subtract them, as it says right here. So, a couple of simple examples, again, this is just the properties and simple examples, is the limit as x approaches negative 4 of x plus 9, a binomial. It's a straight line, a slope of 1, y-intercept of 9. We could have done this in 11.1 by, you know, drawing a picture and seeing the limit graphically, but with these properties and knowing the property of the, for finding the limit of a constant and finding the limit of a identity function, lost it there for a second, I can rewrite this as the limit as x approaches negative 4 of x plus the limit as x approaches negative 4 of 9, and this is a parent function, identity function, and this is a constant. So the limit of x as x approaches negative 4, well, if you let x approach negative 4, then this is going to approach negative 4, and the constant, you know, is a constant, it's horizontal line. The y values are always going to be 9, and the answer is 5. And don't forget, again, we are talking about limits. That is, the x value is approaching a, it's becoming infinitely close to a, and thus this limit, the y value, is also approaching negative 4, and, well, this is going to equal 9 because that's a constant function, it's horizontal. The limit as x approaches 5 of 12x of 12 minus x, again a binomial, it could be a trinomial, it could put 4 terms, I just didn't want to write that much, is the limit of the first term minus the limit of the second term, and the 12 is a constant, the x is going to now be, when separated, the identity function. So the limit of a constant is a constant itself. The limit of x is going to be whatever the x value is approaching, whatever a is. So that's going to be 5, and 12 minus 5 is equal to 7. Woo! All right, now we've got the limit of a product. Now in these two examples, especially the bottom orange one, you're going to see that it's getting kind of ridiculous how much work I'm showing to do these problems. And you'll also start to notice that I'm showing a lot of notation here, but and I'm breaking these limits off into little pieces, giving each term their own limit. Now I'm going to give each factor their own limit. That's why we're going to build into the last couple of properties, which really is going to just sort of streamline this process of finding a limit for functions. So the limit as x approaches a of f of x times g of x is equal to the limit as x approaches a of f of x times the limit as x approaches a of g of x. Basically, this is one term, it's got two factors, or product of two numbers. We're going to find the limit of each of those factors and then multiply them together. So the limit as x approaches 5 of negative 6x is equal to the limit as x approaches 5 of negative 6 times the limit as x approaches 5 of x. Basically, again, if you understood, hopefully I did a good enough job explaining that those first two initial properties, limit of a constant, limit of the identity function, what we're now seeing is, you know, we can pull apart addition, subtraction, multiplication, we'll be able to pull apart division too, that'll be the last example, and basically write it all up into a bunch of little tiny limits of constants and identities, and indeed here we get negative 30. To be, you know, extremely strict on this idea of I can only find the limit of the identity function and I can only find the identity of a constant. If I'm given or asked to find the limit as x approaches negative 2 of 7x squared minus 4, well, I need to expand all that multiplication out and the subtraction and get 7 times x, which is x squared minus 4, and then pull apart with the, you know, limit of a product property and the difference property, the give put the limit function on the 7, limit as x approaches negative 2 of 7, apply it to both the x's as well, so we're going to take the limit of 7, the limit of x, and the limit of 4, and use the product property and the summation or difference property. I don't really know why I wrote plus minus there. I should have just had minus the limit of 4, but anyway, it's going to work out anyway. And take the limit of each constant and each identity function separately and get 24. But you might be going, isn't negative 2 squared 4 and 4 times 7, 28, and 28 minus 4 equal to 24? Why am I showing all of this work? Well, it's just the small building blocks, the small baby steps to get up to the bigger properties, which you're now starting to realize is going to have a pretty obvious pattern. So let's talk about the limit of a monomial and the limit of a polynomial. Woo! Love this stuff. So here are those patterns. We have the limit of a monomial. And don't forget, with a monomial, we're talking about a single term. Basically, a polynomial is a collection of monomials, which these terms have a real coefficient and an exponent, which is a whole number. So, like say 2x squared is a monomial, but 2x square root of x, which is basically 2x to the 1/2 power, would not be considered a monomial. So, when you have a monomial, as you saw in my previous examples, and it's going to be kind of the same with polynomials, you basically just plug them in. The limit as x approaches a of b of n, x sub n, is equal to b sub n times a sub n. You can see where the x is coming out, and the a is just getting plugged in, as you saw with my last example on the previous screen, where I took it apart in all those tiny little steps. So the limit as x approaches 4 of negative 2x cubed is equal to negative 2 times 4 cubed equals negative 2 times 64, which is negative 128. And if you just have a collection of monomials, same thing, you just, you know, take that value of a and plug it in for x and find the limit of your polynomial. And just one more time, let's remember that this looks just like straight substitution, but it's because we were able to build up on those small little blocks of properties. And, you know, we don't just always take a and plug it into the polynomial or the math function we're dealing with, and we're not always able to get those limits. We're following some, you know, specific set of directions here, properties that allow us to do that. Otherwise, you know, you might have to make that table or make that graph to actually find the limit, either visually or numerically, with your t-table. Limit of a power, the limit as x approaches a of f of x, your function, and that entire function is raised to a power of n. Well, you're going to be allowed to take the limit of the inside of that function, and then once you find the limit, then apply the power of n, such as the limit as x approaches 3 of negative 2x plus 11 squared, so that whole binomial being squared. Well, I can, you know, basically just temporarily let the power of 2 float out here at the top, find the limit as x approaches 3 of negative 2x plus 11, and then once we find that limit, this is a polynomial, again a collection of monomials which all have whole number exponents and real coefficients. We go, okay, that's a polynomial. I can just take the value of 3, plug into that expression, work it out, get 5, and then when I'm done, apply that original power of 2 that was applied or on the binomial and say, well, 5 squared is 25. So I got two more properties. We have the property of roots, which basically can just is a rewritten version of limit of finding limit of a power, which is, you know, finding limits of roots. And then we have that last property, which is going to be how to find limits of a quotient. And that is going to be where, when you go into the next video where I do a lot of more you know, complicated examples, if you will, most of our examples are going to be about finding limits of quotients and limits of piecewise functions, because those are actually the ones that take the most amount of work to find the limit, such as with quotients, you can be having an issue where you're trying to divide by 0. So here we have our last two properties. And we have limit of a root, which we know fractional exponents or rational exponents. We can basically rewrite this property in terms of a rational exponent and thus relate it exactly to a power. But when you have your radical notation, limit of a root, the limit as x approaches a of the nth root of a function And n does need to be greater than or equal to 2 for this to work. And why would you take the first root? The first root is going to be the same thing. What's the first root of 4? 4, because, you know, it doesn't make any sense. So n has to be greater than or equal to 2. Well, what you can do is you can take the limit of the function that's inside that root, just like you could take the limit of the function that was inside your power, or your exponent. So the limit as x approaches a of the nth root of f of x is equal to the nth root of the limit as x approaches a of f of x, which then is equal to, you go ahead and find the limit of that function and then take the nth root of it, such as over here, the limit as x approaches 3 of the square root of 4x squared minus 9. I picked this example, by the way, because at least in pre-calculus, a lot of my students, when they see all the values underneath, say, a square root, could be a cube root as well, but whatever. When you see a bunch of values that are sort of perfect square roots in this example, students will want to just say, well, this is 2x minus 3. If I cover up that 9 and put one term inside the square root symbol, then the square root of 4x squared is 2x, the square root of 4 and the square root of x squared. However, once you get a polynomial inside there, it does not work that way. So we cannot take the square root of 4x squared minus 9 as it sits. Algebraically, it's going to be as simplified as it gets. So we're going to take the limit of that inside function, limit as x approaches 3 of 4x squared minus 9, and we're going to, that, you know, is a polynomial, real coefficients and whole number exponents. So we're going to take that 3, plug it in, and work it out until we get a value of 27, and then take the square root of 27. Well, the square root of 27, the square root of 27 has a perfect square in 27. It's 9. It's 9 times 3. And we can't square root 9. The square root of 9 is equal to 3. So this is our limit in reduced form. Now, then the last property, which I'm not going to do any examples in this video, because really that's going to be the 4 of these 6 examples in my next video of actually doing finding limits of some more complicated functions than what we had in this video. 4 of them are going to deal with quotients, because you can't divide by 0. So the limit as x approaches a of f of x over g of x is equal to the limit of the top, the numerator, the polynomial in the numerator, or the function, excuse me, may not be a polynomial. The limit as x approaches a of the numerator divided by the limit as x approaches a of the denominator. We're going to take those two limits and then, you know, divide them out. And, of course, that's not going to work if the denominator comes out to be 0 when we try to find that limit. Well, some of these quotients are going to be set up in such a way, or be possible, where we can algebraically manipulate them and make the fraction, the quotient, you know, not change its value, but appear different, and manipulate in such a way that we can take that value of a and plug it in and not get an undefined value, and thus be able to find the limit by just simply using properties instead of doing, again, a graphical display of the function or a numerical t-table to find that limit. So, that's it for properties of limits. Let's do another video with 6 examples, 4 of which are going to be dealing with this limit of a quotient. So I hope you keep watching. I'm Mr. Tarrou. Bam! Go do your homework!